the center of the universe, everything was made in you. Jesus, breath of every living thing, everyone was made for you. You hold everything together. You hold everything together. Oh Christ, be the center of our lives, be the place we fix our eyes, be the center of our lives.
Hannah, we love you. Hannah's the little granddaughter of Danya's mom here, so I want you to be remembering Hannah, okay, this morning. Wow, we're in part six. We only have two more weeks of what Paul was challenging the people in Colossae about, which we have been talking about is not far removed from what we're still dealing with today, which is pushing Christ out of the picture and saying, well, he was a good teacher, and he was a good prophet, but we really don't need him in the center. We need good religious practice. If we can just be good enough, maybe that would be, we can put in the center. If we can worship other things in our life that are sort of like Christ, and then in their times it was angels, maybe that would be enough. And what was happening was that the church was crumbling in Colossae. And Paul sent a letter to the church and said, here's the great formula. Crack open the little candle wax. Crack it open. And when you open this letter, there's going to be this incredible formula for how to bring everything back to greatness in your church and in your town. Ready? Open up the letter. And it said, put Christ in the center. Because what you have been doing is been putting Christ around in other places. Bring him back to the middle. And in the first few weeks, we said, you know, if you're right off the bat, if you just want your life to be more productive, if you want your life to mean something, if you want your life to have purpose, then let's just start right there with the truth that Jesus Christ was the Son of God and that he was our Savior. And the songs that we're singing and all this stuff is more than just words. And Jackie's up here preparing us for God's holy word by singing her guts out. She's preparing us for the word that Paul was saying. Christ is in the middle. He's the center. And he said he is first. And most of you want, you know, your relationships to be good, and you want your job to be good, and you want your kids to be good, and you want your everything to just to be perfectly structured. And Paul said, if you want that, then put Christ front in preeminence, he said. That was the word he used. And so in the first two chapters, Colossians 1 and 2, he said, listen, it starts with that right there. It starts with truth. And if you can get around that, and if you can move forward from that, then it's time to put it into action. And last week was a tough week. I'm with you. Last week was a tough week because it listed things in Colossians that maybe some of us didn't think were that bad. I mean, really, the sexual stuff outside of marriage, is that still a big deal? Come on, our culture, that's not a big deal. That's on every show that you can turn on. Put it on PBS. Yes, they have it on there. Put it anywhere. Put it on the Disney Channel. Come on, they have it. It's not even that big a deal anymore. And then Paul listed it as one of the things that said, now that you believe in truth, here are things that you have to put to death in your life. If you call yourself a person who's gone into the water and come out of the water a new person, if you have been baptized today, or you are in here today and you have been baptized, and Sydney, you were baptized and you went into the water, you came out a new person. And Paul said, if you came out a new person, it's time to put to death these things in your life. Filthy language, gossiping, slander, all the things that we still see all around us all the time, even with good church people. And these are the things that he said, we have to put these things to death before you can really have real life. And that was in the beginnings of Colossians 3, 1 through 11. If you weren't here, go back to it. Okay, I know you're like, oh, I don't want to hear all that stuff because I like what I mean. I don't want to know what the bad stuff was. But, and Paul said, listen, you got to know what you got to put to death before you really have life. And God has called us to put to death the things that are killing us. And our relationships, and for those of you, I got a young couple in here, Sarah and TJ, they're going to be married. They're in that stage. It's like, yo, we're planning. It's going to be fun. It's going to be awesome. You know, and right, it is, right? It is. But there's this moment after the wedding, right? And you're sitting in here, and, you know, you married people like, oh, amen, boy, amen. Hey, amen. That was good. I mean, I remember some things from my wedding day and wedding night, and, you know, I remember, but the marriage is now, right? The marriage. And God was saying, man, we have to put to death some of the things that are killing us. And what are they? I mean, the Bible says we're two or one. This isn't a marriage sermon, but let me just throw this in. Two or one, you are together as one. So we have to put to death some of the things that are killing our marriages so that there will be life in ours. My wife texted me the other day and said, I miss you. I want to come home and I'm at work. This is terrible. I want to come home, blah, 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 blah. And I was like, yeah, that I miss you too. I really do. And I was doing something. I wasn't as sweet as she was. And the text kind of stopped for a minute. So then I'll text back, you know, I miss you. I want you to come home, you know, or something. And she texted something back. She said, you know, do you think everybody after 10 years still want that? After 10, we had 10 years, nothing. Mel and Suki, sorry. I mean, you know, Jim and Laura, I'm sorry. But I mean, 10 years, that's all we've been at, 10 years. But she said, do you think after 10 years, people still say that and they want to be together and come home? And I thought, I hope so. I mean, I know I want to see you. I really do. And I'm sitting here thinking that that's the life that I want in my marriage. I want life in my marriage. I don't want death. I don't want her to dread coming home. Ever worked with somebody that just wants to stay over and work, have overtime and be there, you know, oh, got to make the money for the family, man, got to make the money, got to, no, you don't want to go home. No, don't lie to yourself. You don't want to go home. You don't want to go home to your wife. You don't want to go home to your husband because there's not life. That was a side part, I'm sorry. Read it, Colossians 3, 1 through 11. These are short, life-changing verses. But the second part of Colossians 3, which is today, living your new life, it's like this. If I told you, go to the gym. It's incredible. This new life you're going to have, go to the gym. And you're like, oh, you're right, the gym. I'm going to go over here to the $10 gym, or I'm going to go to the extremely expensive gym, wherever you want to go. And you say, I'm going to go to the gym. And you show up into the gym and you walk up the stairs or you walk into the gym and all this workout equipment is here and you have no plan. You ever been there? I was there. I was just there. I mean, wasn't I, Eric? I mean, I referenced back to Eric because Eric was my workout partner. And I would ask Eric, what are we doing today, Eric? I have no idea. I'm just up here milling around. You know, doesn't it feel like that? You're just milling around because you have no plan. No plan for a workout, no part, no specifics. What am I going to work out today? How am I going to leave here today and feel better? And Paul was saying in this, the second part of today was this deal. You've said you'll go to the gym. You're going to rid your life of what you eat and the things you are taking in. You're going to rid your life of those things. But now what are you going to work out? What are the specifics? And each one of us today we need that, don't we? We need specifics. I need something. You said I can go. I'm ready to go. I'm ready to do it. I believe in the truth. I'm going to rid my life of the filthy language and the immorality in my life. I'm going to rid my life of that. But what do I fill that with? You ever heard someone say, I've got a void in my life that I want Christ to fill? And you say, amen, hallelujah. Yeah, you want Christ to fill that void. Awesome. What does that mean? Well, I mean, it sounds, and then they're like, well, I mean, but Christ is going to fill the void. What? With what? What's going to happen when Christ fills that void? And Paul was saying that there's a bunch of us, including myself, who have said that before, that I'm just going to start going to church because I have a void in my life. And when I go to church, I'm going to feel better. Have you ever said that? And now you're sitting here today thinking, why am I here? Because I don't have specifics. Well, Paul said, here's some specifics. Colossians 3:12. Let's start there, all right? the character of a new man, the character of a new person. Therefore, as the elect of God, holy and beloved, therefore, remember that word meant that there was something that was before that, right? And that's what we just went over for that whole period of time just now. That was all of that. And now Paul's saying, therefore now, as the elect of God, as someone who has been chosen and loved by God, if you're into election and predestination, get off of that. Here's what I'm talking about. Every one of us who were called, every one of us who Christ died for, which is every one of us sitting in here, the elect in here, the elect of God, holy and beloved, he says, now what we do, let's put on tender mercies. Let's put on kindness. Let's put on humility. Let's put on meekness, long-suffering, or patience. Let's bear with one another, and let's forgive one another. If anyone has a complaint against another, even as Christ forgave you, so you also must do. But above all these things, put on the love, which is the bond of perfection. Put on the love, which is the bond of perfection. So what do we do? Starting with the first one, and you can follow in your bulletin today. Jarrett's going to stay awake back there, and he's going to be with me. And so, Jarrett, just be with it. Come on, we're going to do it. In your bulletins, there's a pen. Take the notes with you. Take some notes today. I'm going to be giving you a lot of stuff, okay? Starting with the first one. What do we do? If we're somebody says, okay, what's the plan now? What do I need to do? Well, I need to now put on the love of Christ. That has something to do with our clothes, doesn't it? Doesn't it have something to do with an everyday process? Like every day. It's not just for Sunday when you put on, oh, I'm going to put on my Sunday best. How about your Monday best? How about the Tuesday best? How about the hump day best? How about the Thursday best? How about your weekend best? Because Paul was saying we have to clothe ourselves with Christ, the love of Christ. And guess what that is? It's an everyday deal. It's an everyday deal. And isn't it also one piece at a time? I don't know if any of you the one Pee Wee Herman suit and you just put it on together. No one, none of you. You do one at a thing at a time, don't you? Sock, you know, and put on your shirt. And each one of those things means something in the name of Christ. Think about it. What's the thing that you need work on that morning? You know, you got your wife right there next to you and you need to be patient. You need to be loving. Yeah, yep, put that on. Put that sock on. Yeah. Your kids are running around going nuts and you just, you know, they just look at you and say, Dad, I just want you to love me today. Care really about my schoolwork. Care really about that. I did the other morning, I sent Ty off to the bus without doing his homework. And that apparently is not a good thing in my house. And Christy said, we just don't send them to the bus stop without their doing their homework. I said, he's a kindergarten, seriously? I mean, and she's like, yeah, seriously, we don't send them off without that. And what she basically was saying was care more about your child before you send him off to the bus stop. So, I'm looking, I'm thinking, I think I need to be better about that. So I put that sock on. And I think for each one of us, it's good to say and wear Christian shirts, right? That say good things, but unless the love is included in what we're wearing, then it really means nothing. Right? How do I love others like Jesus did? And Paul's challenging us to clothe ourselves with love, to be somebody who's putting on the love of Christ. How do we do that? We recognize three things really quick. We recognize that we are chosen people, that he's calling you. He's called you. Just read scripture. He's called you in your school. Somebody this week will need the love of Christ. Somebody this week will need the love of Christ in your workplace. Somebody in your family today needs the love of Christ, and you have been chosen to give that. Also, that you are a holy person. And for those of you that get your minds around that and say that you are holy, guess what? You are holy. If you believe on the name of Jesus, you are holy, which means you have been set apart for holiness. You have been set apart to be different. It doesn't just work here. I'm telling you, it doesn't just work in this place. This place is awesome, and it's cool to be holy and to raise your hands. Where it really has to work is when you leave here, where everybody says there's something different about that person. There's something different. How they reacted in the workplace to how everybody else reacted is something different. And that means that we are holy and we're set apart. We have to recognize that about ourselves. And then we have to understand that we're dearly loved by God Himself. You know, those that struggle with being loved, you know, those, they're very hard people who love others. Isn't that true? You ever seen somebody for struggling with being loved? It's very hard to love people back. And what Paul, when he's writing this, he's saying, if we're going to put on the love of Christ, we have to understand how much we are loved first. What he says in the first verse of 12, beloved, you have been loved. So now, let's love as well. We got to make some daily choices. I love how he put these things down. He listed a bunch of things. Those are workouts. Those are get over there on the bicep curls, right there, because that's tender mercies. Get over there. There's gentleness over there. The long suffering is those curls, those things you lay on and do the back, those things right there. I pass by those every time. Ask Eric. We'll just all say it together. Eric said, hey, you want to get some of those? No. I pass right by that thing because that back curl gets the hamstrings. I don't need that. And that's what we say. We pass by certain things to, you know, where we still need the full workout. And Paul's listing them. He's saying there's just these great ones right here. And I love how he listed things in the first 11 verses of 3, and then he lists the things we can replace them with in 12 through 14. Compassion, kindness, humility, thinking more of others. Some of us think humility is thinking less of yourself. No, humility is thinking more of others, not less of yourself. Isn't that what Christ did? What if Christ came here all with his insecurities? Shucks, I shouldn't be here. I'm not good enough to be. That's not what he did. He knew he was the king, but he thought more of us. And I wonder if we can do the same. You can go in and say you're the king. You can go in and say that you're big and bad. You can go in and think that. But how about you treat someone better than that? Imagine what that would do in your homes. Imagine what that would do in your marriages. Gentleness, patience. I mean, just what about in the shopping line? You're just waiting in the shopping line. You ever been to a place that I won't call its name out, called Walmart, that they have 90 lines and 3 are open? And then you're like, I'm going to do the self-checkout, but that's broken just for today. And you're just sitting there and you're just thinking, and you got somewhere to go, and oh, isn't it boiling? And your SCC shirt is, you're wearing it, and you're just thinking, I just know someone's going to call me on this. Someone is going to tap you on the shoulder and say, hey, pastor, how's your church doing? And you just want to punch them. And Paul's saying, no. Replace that with these. So you wanted things today. Bear grievances with one another. Someone's annoying you. People, I mean, come on. Aren't we always annoyed? We're always going to be annoyed, and we bear with each other. Don't you want to be bared with? Bored with? Whatever the word is, I don't know. Don't you want someone to look at you and say, I'm going to put up with you today because I love you? Because every one of you are thinking, that's not you. No one has to put up with me. No, I'm putting up with you now for just thinking that. All right? Someone's going to put up with you. So he says, then put up with someone else. There's something to work on. And then finally he says, and how about forgiving the sins of each other? And you know what forgiveness means? Let me just give you some quick things on this. You don't bring up the matter with the person. Yeah, remember that time I forgave you about that when you sold me out? Remember that time you got me fired from my job? That was hilarious. That was fun. And you're just like, I hate you so much right now. It's boiling up. And we don't bring it up, do we? And I know I could get deep in each one of us. Maybe we have parent things going on. The parents did us wrong. And each time we're with them at Thanksgiving, we just want to talk about, yeah, you remember that? Yeah, remember, Mom, when you didn't let me go there and hang with that crew? Remember, Mom, when you were mean to me and yelling at me in front of my friends? Remember, Mom, when you were doing... That's not forgiveness, Paul says. Because what if God did that? What if he sat us down every time and said, let me remind you of the things that you've done? Hey, let me remind you of the things that I put my son on the cross for you. How you feeling right now? But we'll do that, won't we? Won't we do that in forgiveness? We'll want to bring that stuff up, but that's not forgiveness. We don't gossip about it to other people. We don't say, I did forgive them. Let me tell you what they did to me. Because they might do it to you too. And even if they don't, I still want to talk bad about it. Is that really forgiveness? What if God was up with the angels right now talking about your business? Yeah, there's Alex down there. You're not all-knowing angels. Let me tell you what she did. Yeah, she did that. Isn't she just nasty? Isn't it the same thing that we, that's not forgiveness. And then finally, what about this? Forgiveness means we don't remind ourselves of what has been forgiven over and over again. We just don't do it. Our hearts are changed. Moving on, Colossians 3:15. He says, and let the peace of God rule in your hearts. Again, these are specifics. You asked for them. You were saying, okay, I'm in the gym. What do I need to do now? Well, how do I need to be better? He says here, verse 15, let the peace of God rule in your hearts, to which also you were called in one body. So be thankful. Be thankful for that. We're ruled by the peace of Christ. That's what we're ruled by. Do you know what that word really even means? When they were saying rule, it's an athletic term. I love this. It's an athletic term that actually means umpire. And you know I love it. My background is in baseball, so I was like, wow. So we're umpired by the peace of Christ. I have two quick stories to tell you. The first one is in 1984, 85. I can't remember. For this story, I'll go with 84. Okay, so my stepfather was the umpire of our little league scrimmage we were having. I'll never forget this to this day. It's 84, okay? And I'm coming around second, going to third. I'm scoring, ball thrown to the plate. My stepdad's there. And in 84, I thought my stepdad was a jerk, okay? I'm just going to tell you. If he was here, he knows that, all right? But he was just, to this day, he's the man who raised me and made me what I am, okay? I get out at home, and he gets face to face with me and says, you're out, like he enjoyed it. And if he was here, he could reenact the whole thing, and I could slide across the floor, and he would do it again. I mean, and I'll never forget, 84, I'll never forget that moment when he said, you are out. And I was thinking, again, back to the term, we are ruled by the peace of Christ, and at times, we are umpired by the peace of Christ who tells us you are out of bounds right now. You're out. Get back in. 1994. Again, this is real. 1994. Okay, 84, 85, I can't remember. 94. I'm playing in the All-State game. All right? And it's the bottom of the seventh, ninth, forget what we played. And it's a tie game. Actually, I think we're down by one. I don't remember. We're down by one. So I hit a ball out to center field. Goes over the center fielder's head. He tries to dive for it. It bangs off the wall. And I'm rounding second. We score a run. It's tied now. I'm rounding third. I'll never forget the coach from Edmond North is bringing me around. And I am going to slide in. If I slide in, I win the All-State game. Ball through the plate. Slide in. Safe. And oh my gosh, to this day, I could relive it every second of that moment, sliding in and them saying I'm safe and all the players from the different places coming and cheering. And I go back to the illustration that we are umpired by the peace of Christ who tells us you are safe. And the umpire is the one who has the final say. Isn't that right? It's the peace of Christ that has the final say. And Paul reminds us that we are ruled by the peace of Christ. There's nothing after that. There's three essentials for peace I want to share with you. That if you want to be ruled by the peace of Christ, you have to understand that you need each other. That you're not going to do it by yourself. We only won the game because there was a runner in front of me that scored. You with me? We're also called for this. This is what we're challenged to do. We're called to have peace. We're called to have peace with each other. And then finally, he says, we're called to be thankful for it. If you are a person who's thankful, aren't you a peaceful person? How many of you know people who just aren't thankful people in their life? Are they peaceful? How many of you are struggling with your thankfulness right now in the moment you're in, just to be thankful for what God has given you? Aren't you struggling with peace right now? Paul's saying we have to be thankful for what we have. He goes on in verse 16. He says, let the word of Christ dwell in you, or live in you richly in all wisdom, teaching and admonishing one another, encouraging one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing with grace in your hearts to the Lord. He says we're to be inhabited or indwelt with the word of Christ within us. And how do we do that? How do we even know the word of Christ unless we're actually reading it? And we're actually awake this morning as I'm sharing with you the word of Christ. How do you even know it? How does it live in you unless you're studying it? How do you even have that? How do we teach each other if we don't even know it? And some of you are scared to death to be teachers. You say, I can't, small, you're not going to have me ask the questions, are you? You're going to have me say stuff in small. I don't want to teach. But that's what we're called to do. And how do we teach? Is that we have to read and know the stuff. Because I promise you, guess what? There's people around you who are going to ask you, I don't know what to do right now. I don't know what to do in this situation, and I'm not going to be anywhere around you. There's not going to be Mr., person who knows everything. You have to know what to say. And let me give you a little trick. It's called Google. I'm dead serious. Let me give you a little trick that's called Google, Sarah Roberts. Because, it's like, hey, what are some cool marriage verses that you could just to encourage us, just to keep us going? What is that? Do you think I'm like, well, let me tell you. 1 Timothy 4, you go there. 1 Corinthians 13, 4, about the love. No, I'm like, okay, she needs a lot of marriage verses. I mean, you know what? I'm going to Google this right now. And I'm going to see all the marriage verses. And I'm going to say, wow. And do you think I'm going to type them all up and pretend like I'm the one that pulled them all from the Bible in that 5 seconds? No, I'm going to send her the link. And I'm going to say, this is worthwhile. Check all these verses out. Don't we all have that same power to do that? You're looking at me like, he knows everything in the Bible. No, I'm telling you, no. I just know where to get the answer. And so do you. And that's how we teach and encourage one another. And you're probably thinking I'm a sham right now, but that's all right. You deal with your own self. Because let me tell you what else we're here to do is encourage one another, right? And when we send each other this word, isn't it encouraging? Isn't it encouraging when you see it and you're like, wow, there is a verse that just tells me to be still and know that He is God and He will love me. Psalm 46:10. He just to settle down right now. For those of you that can't settle down, I saw a lady tear into a parking spot today, just like Dukes of Hazzard around the corner. I'm outside just drinking my coffee, just chilling out, looking at the beautiful, get out of the car, hurry up, we gotta go, hurry. And I was like, hey, calm down, but we gotta, and we, sometimes we can't lose that feeling, can we? Like, you're sitting in here right now, but you feel late to something. You feel on edge. Oh, I got to hurry and get to mow the lawn. I got to hurry. Whoa, the game finished. Whoa, I got to hurry. And it's like, just be still. Be still, especially right now. My goodness. The pizza will wait. What are the people going to do around you that need the word? Are you sharing it with them? Because when God's word dwells in you and you believe that it's worth something, then you have something worth saying to them. If you're going to babble a bunch of stuff about just, be hopeful. Just have hope. Have hope. It'll all be better. This too shall pass. This will. Give them some solid word from Scripture. I promise you, they're not going to tell you, that's really not worth anything. And if they do, then their deal won't work out anyway. Colossians 3:17. Finally, he says, and whatever you do in word or deed, do all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him. We do everything in the name of Christ. You're sitting here today and you're hearing the word of Christ over and over again. You might be getting bored with it. I'm sorry. Paul said, listen, if you really want to be a different person, a renewed person, then put Christ in the center, and then everything you do now, do it in the name of Christ. Everything. Everything you do, do it in the name of Christ. And you're thinking, oh, brush my teeth in the name of Christ. Oh, sure. Yeah. Grocery shop in the name of Christ. Yeah, sure. You know, oh, just drive down the street in the name of Christ. Yeah, sure. You're just being a smart aleck. That's fine. That's everything you can call out. Sure. Do it in the name of Christ. But there's something more to that. And I want to tell you what's in the name of Christ. We have his purpose when we're doing it. This is what it meant. When Paul said, do it in the name of Christ, that when you do something in the name, then it had purpose to it. So when you say all these things you're listing, and I'm going to raise my family in the name of Christ, yes, you raise your family with purpose in his name. You also are raising your family with his power. That's what you're saying. When you say, I'm going to do it in the name of Christ, whatever this is, I'm going to work today in the name of Christ, just the everything, routine, mundane things in life, don't you need some inspiration for those things? I heard someone today, I just need a new job. I hate my job. I need to get out of my job. And Paul's saying those everyday, routine, mundane things you can still do in the name of Christ because he's given you purpose. And he's giving you his power. And you know what else? He's giving you the promise on the other side. That if you'll just be patient, and you can look at it in 2 Peter, that says, God will promote you at the right time. And isn't that the promise on the other end? Today, there's some growth work I want to share with you. And you can write this in your bulletins, or you can try to remember it if you're good like that. I want you to write down the name of one person whom you're going to act in the love, in the name or in the love of Christ. Okay? Write down just one name of one person that you're going to really put to act the love of Christ with today. And it starts inside out. I just want to share that with you. If you're saying somebody at my work and then you just can't stand your kids or your wife, let's start on the inside and it goes out. Just a hint for some names. What about one decision where you need the rule of the peace of Christ, that you need the umpire to come say, you're out. Let's get the peace back. Write down one decision where you need the rule of the peace of Christ. What about one believer with whom you can share the word of Christ? One believer who's just struggling right now. One believer who's in the hospital right now. One believer who just lost her mother, right, or her mother had a heart attack. What one believer who's struggling right now, can you give them a word of hope from Scripture? Can you text it to them right now? Can you share it with them when you visit them in the hospital? Because a believer will take your word and say, I believe that. And it's going to encourage me right now. And finally, what about one place where you can begin acting in the name of Christ? One place in wherever it is, school, work, home, athletic teams, wherever, where you can start saying, everything I do, I'm going to do with his purpose, I'm going to do it with his power, and I'm going to believe in the promise that comes from this. Amen? Let's pray. Father God, thank you for bringing us here and teaching your word to us, Father. I pray that by Paul giving us the specifics, Father, of how to replace the things that are killing us with things that will give us life, Father, that we will put those into practice. I pray that each person today will go back and look at those, that 25, 30 minutes in a service, Father, is not enough. We have to go to your word, Father. Thank you, Father, for your holy word. Today, Father, I lift up people who are going to be faithful in their giving to the church, God. And Father, I pray for what your word teaches us, Father, that you return that in our lives. Father, we're not people who quantify that, Father. We're people who just believe it. And Father, we're asking for you to be creative and find favor in the lives of those people who are faithful in their giving to your kingdom and your ministry. I pray a prayer over that offering today. Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen.